Hello, I'm KMO, host of the CROM podcast, and I've just read a really compelling book. It's called Splinterlands by John Feffer, and it's basically a geopolitical tour of the year 2050. And it's kind of grim, to say the least. And joining me from Washington, D.C. by Skype, I have the author on the line. John Feffer, thanks for joining me.
Nice to be on your show.
So the book Splinterlands, it's about 150 pages. It went really, really quickly.
Yes.
A Harry Potter novel, it is not. Those things tend to weigh several pounds.
Yeah, this one is easy to take to the beach if you're looking for a dystopian novel for the beach, of course.
And if you're flying to the beach, you'll probably finish it before you get to the beach.
Pretty quick.
So in terms of novels have different purposes. And I suspect that this novel has a particular purpose. Would you describe what you had in mind when you were writing this?
Sure. Well, I was asked basically to kind of look into the future for an essay I wrote about a year ago. And I was looking at kind of the future of basically U.S.-Russian EU relations. And it struck me as I was trying to think about the big picture that big picture wasn't really the right word to describe the future, that things, at least according to what the trend lines look like about a year ago, seem to be looking towards more fragmented future of smaller and smaller entities. About a year ago, I was looking at the EU coming under a lot of pressures, a lot of shocks. I was looking at the United States, you know, perpetually dealing with deep divisions between population as well as kind of significant fracturing even in Washington, D.C. among the political actors here. And looking out at the world at large, obviously a lot of pressures coming from global phenomena like climate change, pandemics, economic inequality. So I wrote an essay basically looking at what the potential trajectory would be for a kind of scenario of fragmentation for the world at large. And we published that at Tom Dispatch, which is a kind of a site that focuses on foreign policy. And it was quite popular. So the editor there, Tom Engelhart, asked me, well, could you turn it into a book? And I thought, gee, do people really want to read an entire book about kind of the splintering of geopolitics? And I thought, well, they might if it were a novel. In other words, if there was some kind of human interest in the text as well. And so I kind of created a family and a kind of scenario in which not only is the main character looking at the fragmenting of the world, but is trying to understand the fragmenting of his own family. And so that was kind of the premise of it. But I should add that, you know, a year ago when I was thinking about this, I was not anticipating the two major events of 2016, the Brexit vote in the UK and the election just recently of Donald Trump here in the United States. I really intended the novel to be a kind of wake-up call for people dealing with a scenario in which the British rejected Brexit and stayed in the EU, and the American voters rejected Donald Trump. And I wanted to say, look, even though you've done these things, the trend line suggests that we're going to head in this direction anyway. So, of course, I was really quite surprised when Brexit and Trump proved victorious over the last year.
Do you know of a performance artist, a monologuist named Mike Daisy?
Of course, absolutely.
So he's got a show, a monologue that he does called The Trump Card. And the final performance of The Trump Card that he did just before the election, he basically got to the end of his monologue and he says to his mostly liberal audience, because, you know, who goes to a stage play with one person talking about Donald Trump just before the election? And he's sort of scolding his liberal audience and he says, you know, there's two possible outcomes coming up. One I won't talk about, because if Donald Trump wins, then, you know, the skies will part and blood will rain down and, you know, it will be hell on earth. So let's consider the more likely possibility. And then he has, you know, a rap about still, you know, liberals need to be not so complacent.
Yeah.
Well, we got the fire and, you know, blood falling from the sky scenario.
Right. Right. So complacency is not really the concern at the moment. I think people are very eager to do something. They may not know exactly what to do. I mean, we're still in this kind of lull of the lame duck period, and there's mobilizing around, for instance, trying to convince Electoral College to vote differently than the way they've been pledged. But other than that, you know, people are just kind of bracing for impact.
So back to your novel, would you describe the main character?
Sure. So the main character is Julian West, and he's an academic who, you know, was doing pretty, I would say, standard academic work up until, you know, around 2016, 2017. And he focused on the EU, and, you know, he's kind of a not an obscure kind of fellow. But then, beginning in 2016, 2017, he started to look at the deterioration of these larger structures in the world, the fragmentation of the European Union, the seeming collapse of a number of international institutions like the International Criminal Court, and some fracturing of major countries as well, as kind of nationalism begins to tear apart countries like China and Russia, and even pull apart the United States. And so he begins to write a kind of treatise about this. And in so doing, he creates what he calls a new discipline. You know, he's kind of a conventional political scientist up to that point, but he creates something called geopaleontology. Geopaleontology is basically a combination of geopolitics and paleontology. And he's trying to understand why these huge organizations, basically these dinosaurs, went extinct, or at the time were going extinct. And so he writes his magnum opus, which he calls Splinterlands, and it comes out in 2020, and it proves to be prescient. Many people are looking at it not as a historical document in which he's trying to explain the collapse of the Soviet Union or Yugoslavia or the unraveling of the European Union, but they start to look at it as a kind of prophecy of what will happen. And it turns out through the 2020s that he's correct. Now, at the same time that he's writing about the fragmenting of the world community, his wife has left him and moved to Vermont. His children have moved to other countries and have stopped speaking with him. And he is, you know, focused on his success, so he doesn't really, you know, I mean, he's not particularly happy about this, but he is so focused on his professional success that he doesn't really attempt to understand why this is happening to him at the time. And so that's Julian West, and that's kind of the premise of the novel as well.
Well, I'll tell you what I enjoyed about reading the novel. Many things. I'm interested in the topics. I mean, if this were a nonfiction take on the same subject matter, I would be interested. But I like that it's a narrative by Julian West, but that there are footnotes written by somebody else, oftentimes correcting West's either his forgetfulness or his ability to cut himself an enormous amount of slack. What's the framing of the novel? Because as you've mentioned already, the title, Splinterlands, a novel, the Splinterlands is actually a nonfiction book that the author had written 30 years before the current narrative.
Correct. And
so who's the footnote writer?
Yes, so the footnote writer is one of his disciples, a son figure, if you will, who is also a geopaleontologist, and who has focused a great deal on the career of Julian West. But as you can imagine, you know, there's often some Oedipal tensions between fathers and sons. And so there is quite a bit of tension between this footnote writer, Emmanuel Puig, and Julian West. And as you say, the footnotes not only correct the record, but also tell a different story, a subtext, a literal subtext of the book. Because there's something that Julian West is not telling his readers. He is the kind of archetypal, unreliable narrator. And sometimes it takes, you know, for in other novels, unreliable narrators trip themselves up. But in this case, we have these footnotes that, that trip up Julian West and tell an entirely different story about the breakup of his marriage. And I won't go into the details of that, but you kind of get this story in bits and pieces as the book goes on. And, you know, I was inspired to do that for two reasons. One, well, he's an academic, and of course, you know, academics love footnotes, and I wanted to play with that. I wanted, you know, the footnotes to actually be, you know, the petard that hoists Julian West, so to speak. It's the person who focused so much during his life on footnotes is thus undone by these footnotes. But I was also, you know, very taken by two other models, two novels that I really enjoyed reading. One was Nabokov's Pale Fire, which is a book that's, you know, basically half footnotes and half text. And Nabokov just loves, you know, poking fun at academics. And the other one is Kiss of the Spider Woman, which is has footnotes that are basically written by a psychotherapist who psychotherapizes the main character. So I really wanted to take those two and mush them together, if you will, have a mashup, and kind of inject that into Splinterlands as well.
I want to talk about your book strictly on its own merits, but as soon as I announced to the Sea Realm listenership that I was reading it, I immediately received questions asking me to compare it to the Lionel Shriver novel, The Mandibles. Have you read that novel?
I haven't, though I did see it. A couple people had mentioned it in comments, but to be honest, I hadn't read it. So have you read it?
I have, yeah. Yeah, I liked it quite a bit.
How would you compare the two?
Well, Lionel Shriver, she's, I think, best known for a book that she wrote that got made into a movie, We Need to Talk About Kevin. So she is really, really good at writing dialogue. So most of her book, it's similar to yours in that the setting is very constrained. So in your book, Julian West is basically in a hospital bed for most of the novel, just in a hospital room. We don't, as far as I know, don't really know where. And in Shriver's novels, there's a few locations. There's a nursing home, I think a small home in Brooklyn, in the neighborhood where I lived in Brooklyn until just recently. So I could visualize the neighborhood very clearly in the book. And I think there's at the end, there's a road trip, basically, to Nevada, which is the new, you know, remaining free state when everything else has fallen to hyper-liberalism and cashless society and basically millennials enslaved to servicing the aging baby boomers.
sounds promising.
So her book is very, very rich in terms of the psychology of the characters and the dialogue and the ability of the dialogue to make these characters seem very real. But at the same time, she's obviously a libertarian, and I say this with all you know, fondness, because I myself come from that lineage, but she's clearly a libertarian and a gold bug, and she has a very obvious and deliberate axe to grind. And I didn't get the axe grinding from your book. It seemed that Julian, you know, the narrator's perspective was basically, well, I won't say what his ultimate aim is, because that comes near the end of the book, and it's a bit of a surprise. But through most of the text, it seems like his main concern is his own legacy and his own, you know, how he is perceived by the public, and which is, you know, a pretty small motivation, but it's also one that's easy to understand. And it just didn't seem as if it were a smokescreen for it. This book doesn't feel like a polemic.
Yeah, well, I definitely wanted to avoid that. I mean, you know, there are definitely some hobby horses, if you will, that that Julian West gets on.
Mm-hmm. And definitely your hobby horses.
Well, some of them are, definitely. But they are, I would say that they're formed in reaction to his wife and to his children. You know, and you're right, you know, he's mostly concerned about his professional legacy, but he's also very concerned that, you know, that his family has basically gone off in directions that are counter to his thinking. So, for instance, his wife has gone off to Vermont and, you know, to literally cultivate her own garden in a kind of intentional community. in the Northeast Kingdom. One of his sons has, you know, has pursued wealth, as something that Julian West was never particularly interested in. Another son has gone off to fight against the Islamic Caliphate. And whatever Julian West might think about the Caliphate, he's not a big fan of radical Islam, he's certainly no fighter. And so he and his ex-wife are both upset that their son has gone off and done this very dangerous thing. The one, you know, child that has basically pursued something that Julian West values, that is, she became an academic too, she's furious at him because, you know, he did not praise her at all, except if she was moving in the direction of academia. And she wanted to be a poet. And, you know, that was something that he thought was a waste of time and certainly wasn't going to, you know, be an actual profession. And so all of his children and his ex-wife have basically kind of set themselves opposed to him in their thinking and in what they're doing. And in that way, I wanted to kind of both undercut any kind of, you know, definitive polemic in the book, but also provide a range of different perspectives, you know, in some sense mirroring the world at large. You have a kind of fragmentation of Julian West's more or less liberal worldview, and it is kind of distorted and transmogrified by, you know, his family as well as the world at large.
Well, I know that a certain segment of the audience is really impatient with these introductory remarks. They want to get to the red meat of the matter. What is the world like in 2050? Tell me about, you know, the world that has been splintered.
Uh-huh.
Actually, if you don't mind, I'd like to read a short passage from the book, early on in the book.
Sure.
So this is from page 11. It starts, the chapter is called The Great Unraveling. I love this line. I highlighted it. Water boils most fiercely just before it disappears, and so it is, evidently, with human affairs. Before all hell broke loose in 1914, the world witnessed an unprecedented explosion of global trade at levels that would not be seen again for more than six decades. Before the Nazis took over in 1933, Germans in the Weimar Republic were enjoying an extraordinary blossoming of cultural and political liberalism. Before the Soviet Union imploded in 1991, Soviet scholars were proudly pointing to the rising rates of intermarriage among the many nationalities of the Federation as a sign of ever greater social cohesion. And in 2018, just before the Great Unraveling, the world still seemed to be in a frenzy of what was then labeled globalization. And then just skipping to the next page, skipping a few paragraphs, before 2018, almost everyone believed that time's arrow pointed in the direction of greater integration. Some hoped, and others feared, that the world was converging on ever larger conglomerations of nations. And we can tell by the way you phrased that, that that's not the way it went.
Right.
What happened in 2018, and what was the trajectory of the world, basically, from 2020 to 2050?
Well, first I should say that I originally put, you know, 2016 there, not 2018. I mean, this was from the original essay, which was published in 2015. And we gradually pushed it further into the future, in part because, you know, the editor, my editor was thinking, well, we want the book to be current, you know, for a little while longer. And probably nothing's going to happen in 2016 and 17. So now, of course, we're thinking, oh, well, probably that might have been a mistake. But anyway, between 2020 and 2050, you know, basically a number of lines converge. One, you have rising nationalism, and this is perhaps the most significant. And you know, there was expectations in after 1989 that we would see, as Francis Fukuyama called it, the end of history, that all the great kind of passions in geopolitics were, if not over, about to be over, because, you know, all the great ideological struggles had been decided. And, you know, a number of critics said, well, hey, hold on a bit. You know, there's still some ideological issues people are struggling over. And one of the most prominent, of course, is nationalism. And you saw, you know, that emerge quite quickly after 1989 with the disintegration of Yugoslavia And then, as well, a lot of the conflicts that took place in the former Soviet Union, but not just in the former communist world. You had nationalist, basically, rebellions or battles taking place around the world. So I basically extrapolated from that. I said, well, you know, if what we saw in Yugoslavia was the failure of federalism and the failure of basically a multi-ethnic country cohering, there's really no reason to not expect the same kind of trends to hit other huge multi-ethnic countries, particularly China, Russia, and eventually even the United States. So that's one major trend line. Another major trend line is climate change. And climate change is, of course, not only, you know, an issue for people living on islands or on coastlines, it's also ultimately going to be an issue that affects everybody, as effectively there'll be fewer and fewer resources, and not just kind of fossil fuels, but things like water and arable land, that will be available for an ever-growing world population, a population that probably won't kind of peak until 2050 at the earliest. So that will sharpen, you know, the conflicts between countries and ultimately conflicts between communities and individuals as well. And then you still have technology, of course. Technology, you know, providing ever more sophisticated means of communicating. But as with Facebook, I anticipated the technology wouldn't necessarily be bringing people together. It would be establishing different ways for people to divide themselves up into interest communities and smaller and smaller kind of enclaves. And in Splinterlands, the primary technology is virtual reality and how virtual reality enables people both to travel to other places virtually, but not physically, but also to kind of gather together in smaller and smaller groups. For instance, disaster tourists, people who kind of use VR to go with groups to watch wars or earthquakes or what have you, and they're relatively safe and with their VR, but they can indulge in this kind of voyeurism. So all of these trends produce a world which is not, on the face of it, you know, post-apocalyptic. I mean, there hasn't been nuclear war. There hasn't been a virus that has wiped out everybody. But
no zombies.
Nor zombies, right? But it's more the frog in the pot of boiling water, in which the water comes to a very, very slow boil, and the frog doesn't realize it. And so you see all of these changes taking place, but the characters are not kind of roving around the landscape in tattered clothes. I mean, they are in many ways very similar to what we are now, though I would say that their consciousness is quite different than what our consciousness is at the moment.
Well, you mentioned Facebook, and I've read people saying that they are deliberately locking down their Facebook accounts, which is to say they are banishing people who voice differing opinions, and they are making an active effort to increase the filter bubble effect, whereby, you know, they just get an echo of what they already believe. I don't do that. I make a deliberate point of not doing that, but Facebook does it for me. I have, I think, 1,600 so-called friends on Facebook. I never, ever see any posts from Trump supporters. I'm not pushing them away. Facebook is you know, showing me what it thinks I like.
Right.
So it seems like if you were to ask Mark Zuckerberg, Facebook is this thing that lets people, you know, share and collaborate and cooperate and grow closer to one another. And it seems to be having that effect while simultaneously having the opposite effect.
Precisely.
Well,
you know, there was a similar argument that was made in the early part of the 20th century about kind of new forms of communication bringing people together, that whether it was, you know, trains or steamships or the telegraph or eventually the telephone, that these devices would bring people together and therefore erode the kind of antipathies associated with particularism, whether it was nationalism or regionalism or religion. But Ernest Gellner, a kind of scholar of nationalism, pointed out that actually often when you bring people together, there's more conflict, not less conflict, and people start to divide themselves more thoroughly when they come in contact with the quote-unquote other. And so he anticipated that, you know, this was, say, in the 1930s, between the 1930s and the 1950s, as he was writing, that nationalism would, in fact, increase, not decrease, as a result of this enhanced communication and travel. And I could make the same argument about social media, that, as you point out, we have effectively created our own mini caliphates. Of course, you know, we wouldn't call our belief system, you know, radical or exclusionary. But in many respects, because we've created a kind of, as you say, echo chamber, we aren't really testing our ideas against other people, and we're not having the influence of different ideas coming into our sphere. So effectively, you know, we have established our own kind of thought police, if you like. I called it in an essay participatory totalitarianism, that we are ourselves kind of creating this kind of exclusionary surveillance system in which we are providing all of this information about ourselves voluntarily. We're not, you know, waiting for some, you know, thought police to insist that we provide it. In a scenario somewhat similar to Dave Edgar's The Circle. So this is a trend that I find extremely worrying, and it's hard to know exactly how to break out of it unless, you know, we come up with either a counter technology, something that counters this technology, or some additional technology which provides us with, you know, some ability to get outside our own small circles.
Well, in the realm of technology, which is going to pull our butts from the fire, there is the concept in the novel of the green swan. Would you talk about that?
Sure. Well, so folks are usually familiar with the black swan, and, you know, the black swan is the completely unexpected event, the sport of nature, as a black swan is. Although there are far more black swans, and, you know, I think the coiner of the term back in the 17th century thought there were. But it became relatively popular with a book that came out called The Black Swan, by Taleb, and he basically said that, you know, these events are going to come along and they're going to be transformative. And you could argue, for instance, that the victory of Donald Trump in the elections was a black swan. No one anticipated it, you know, with the possible exception of course, a couple of his supporters and Michael Moore. Everybody else said it wasn't going to happen. The Brexit vote would be another black swan. So that's become a kind of established kind of trope. In the novel, there is this concept of the green swan. In other words, something unexpected that comes along, a swan that's green, but one that actually is a technological savior of the human race. And it's what, you know, people talk about all the time, that, you know, we don't have to worry about, you know, for instance, the exhaustion of fossil fuels, because some new technology will come along that will provide sufficient power to keep the grid up and running. Or, you know, yes, we're worried about the mutation of a bird flu, but surely there will be some kind of answer to that particular problem that scientists come up with. So anytime, you know, the human race is threatened by something, whether it's, you know, a cataclysm or its own foolishness, along come scientists or technology experts who invent something that can deal with it. And this is the green swan. It doesn't exist. It simply is something that people hope will come along. And so there's this dialogue between Julian and his ex-wife. And, you know, his ex-wife is quite skeptical that any of these green swans will ever come to pass, including the perhaps the most cherished one, which is that when we've completely fouled up this planet, well, we can go to Mars, and that, you know, there, you know, we can recreate the human race, presumably without any of the problems that, you know, we face here on Earth. And, you know, she points out, well, you know, are we going to be able to actually prevent the human race from taking all of the psychological problems, greed, aggression, egoism, and so forth, to Mars and simply reproduce the same problems we have here on Earth? So this is kind of the conflict between husband and ex-wife that plays out in the book.
And there is a Mars colony in the book.
There is. It's called the Plan B colony, but it fails. And there's some controversy about why it fails, whether it was, you know, some external factor or some internal factor. But, you know, I would like to believe, of course, that the green swan of a Martian colony will come along in time to save some human DNA in some form or another. But, you know, but at the moment, at least, I don't think the prospects are particularly good, regardless of what some billionaire entrepreneurs would like to believe.
Well, Neil deGrasse Tyson has a line that I just love. He says, "We've sent probes to all the different planets in our solar system, and Earth is the best one."
Absolutely.
My take on that is, if we have the resources, the technology, and the energy to turn Mars into the Earth, then we have the same resources to turn the Earth into the Earth.
Correct.
So this is the place where we're going to make our stand. We're going to fail, or we're going to succeed right here.
Right. I mean, it's an illusion that, you know, dates back several centuries, the idea that there will be a new world that we can, you know, escape to, that is both innocent of all the sins of the old world, and abundant in that it has all these incredible natural resources, including perhaps even a fountain of youth that will allow us to live forever. So this kind of illusion of the new world and the expanses of the new world, I think, is almost set into the DNA of Western man, so to speak.
Well, let's talk about some of the other characters in the book. You mentioned there's the main character, Julian West. He has three children. He has a daughter, whom you've mentioned. She lives in Brussels, and she was a Francophile from an early age. She's very European in her self-identity. Talk a little bit about the Brussels in which she lives.
Well, I decided, you know, looking around at the various places I could set a scene in Europe, I thought, well, Belgium is really the perfect place, because in many ways, Belgium has been splintered for decades, for centuries. Here is a country that, you know, always has difficulty kind of putting together a government out of the Walloons, the French-speaking and the Dutch-speaking halves of the country. And Brussels, too, is, you know, emblematic of that. It has, you know, not only Dutch and French speakers, but it also has a large international community. And it is, of course, also the home of the EU. So you have this kind of contradiction between the EU, which attempts to kind of integrate all of Europe, set in a city which is frankly not unified at all. And I wanted also to include this other dynamic, which is this kind of conflict between the remainder of the caliphate, the Islamic State, which the Islamic State itself will probably fall apart, but there will always be this attempt to create a caliphate of.
It's a brand.
Mm-hmm. And then
a franchise, you might say.
Exactly. And then the group that the paramilitaries that are formed around the world to fight these soldiers of the caliphate. And so here in Brussels, you have, you know, the war taking place on practically an everyday level. You have a green zone and a red zone, just as you have in Baghdad, a green zone in which, you know, you have the remnants of European civilization still trying to kind of hold it all together, in a red zone in which the war is ongoing, this global war on terror, not taking place any longer in the safe, at least from the point of view of Europeans and Americans, the safe areas of the third world, but in the very heart of the cities of the West. And so you have in Brussels, Julian West's daughter living in the green zone and studying this phenomenon of fracturing, much like her father, but as I said, resentful of the fact that she's kind of been pushed into being an academic. And, you know, Julian goes to visit her, and you discover she's actually had a couple of kids. He hasn't even been there for their birth. So you start to realize that Julian West has not been the best father on any number of levels. And this is an opportunity for her to kind of, despite their estrangement over the years, to basically push him and say, well, you know, why did you do this? Why did you basically abandon us? And why are you still, why have you come back for a visit? What is on your mind? And so it kind of sets up she's the first of his children that he visits, and it kind of establishes the kind of pattern for his travels by virtual reality around the world.
His oldest son, Gordon, whom I think we could describe to the listeners or the viewers as a billionaire hedge fund manager, lives in a former Chinese province. And I had never heard of it. I had to look it up. I think it is Ningxia. Is that how it's pronounced?
Ningxia, yep.
So what's Ningxia like in 2050?
Sure. Well, first I should say that, you know, I chose all these locations basically because I'd been there recently. So, and I had to write the book under deadline. And so I didn't want to really set anything in places I didn't know. And I'd had the fortune to go to Ningxia to attend a conference. And Ningxia is basically in the Chinese Midwest. It's basically halfway between Beijing and Xinjiang. And Xinjiang is in the far west. It's primarily ethnically Uyghur, although there have been a lot of Han Chinese that have moved there over the years. And Ningxia has survived relatively well the great collapse that took place in China, where, you know, nationalism has divided the country, the splitting off of course, Taiwan and Tibet, but Xinjiang as well. But more importantly, the economic stagnation that China suffered in the 2020s led to a political uprising. The Chinese Communist government has always predicated its survival, basically, on pretty remarkable economic progress, or at least economic growth. Take out that economic growth, if the country starts to stagnate, well, a lot of people are going to be upset about that. And in this case, in the novel, they rise up. And so China falls apart. Xinjiang manages to hold together and absorbs a couple other provinces, including Ningxia. And Ningxia is predominantly Muslim, and I mean, in the future. Right now, it's still a minority Muslim, but in the future, it becomes predominantly Muslim. It is an outpost where Saudi and Gulf interests pour money in. It is a kind of Chinese neoliberal province. The whole area has kind of a mixture of religion and neoliberalism. And it provides enormous opportunities for people like Gordon, who at an early age picked up Chinese, went over there to find his fortune, as many Americans have over the last few years, and settles there and continues to make a huge amount of money, basically betting on chaos. And this is kind of an extrapolation of what already is taking place. I mean, plenty of people, you know, like George Soros, for instance, betting on the collapse of British pound, or others who bet on a fall in the stock market rather than a rise in the stock market. And so effectively, they're placing their bet on chaos. They will profit from chaos. And that is Gordon's prime directive. And, you know, his father is aghast that his son not only profits from this fragmentation, but in some sense encourages it as well, because, you know, he is contributing to the economic trends that are encouraging the economic fragmentation. Now, of course, you know, his son points out that you too, father, have benefited from chaos. Your book, Splinterlands, did quite well. It established you professionally and made you some money. I didn't see you kind of taking the profits you made from your book and investing it in integrating the world. So you and I are peas in the same pod, and there's no reason for you to scorn me. You are simply upset that your son is better at it than you are.
Gordon has a great line where he describes the upper middle class lifestyle of his parents and says that's what caused all this trouble. And Julian pushes back and he says, well, you know, we didn't take cruises and we didn't eat that much meat. And the son says, well, a locust on a diet is still a locust.
Right.
I love that.
Yeah, I mean, this is, I think, a problem we all face, that, you know, here in the United States, even if we are the most modest, and I'll put myself in that category. I don't own a car. I don't use anything on my lawn. I try to be as, you know, environmentally sensitive as possible. But bottom line, I'm still an American, you know? I'm still consuming far more resources per square inch than practically anybody else in the world. I mean, there are a couple others that, you know, but the United States, we are, you know, we're energy hogs and we are, you know, carbon emitters without parallel. And just by virtue of my being in this country, you know, I'm in the nation of locusts. You know, I may be a modest locust, but I'm still a locust. And I think that's something that we all have to kind of face up to at some point. How collectively we deal with this problem, not just individually. I put some solar panels on my house, or I get a Prius, but how collectively we deal with the enormous consumption of resources.
So Gordon and his father have a talk about democracy, and basically the place where Gordon is living is a democracy in name only. They have a single ruling party which changes its name every few years to make it look like there's been a change in power, but there just isn't. Would you talk about the tension between the ability of people to, you know, to find cohesion in the belief that they are participants in their society, balanced with the recognition that democracy eats itself, as John Adams would say?
Right. Well, this was, I've been writing a book, actually, a different book on the rise of authoritarian populism in Eastern Europe, and it's based on about 300 interviews I did in the region a couple years ago. And so I was very influenced by these trends in Eastern Europe, the rise of Fidesz in Hungary and what's called Peace or Law and Justice Party in Poland. But these aren't exclusively right-wing parties. I mean, there are Smer, for instance, in Slovakia is actually on the left side of the political spectrum, and it too is kind of an authoritarian populist party. It seemed to me that we were converging in some sense politically toward this authoritarian populism. And this is even before the election of Donald Trump or Duterte in the Philippines. But that the example of Vladimir Putin in Russia or Erdogan in Turkey, or even Ortega in Nicaragua. These were a kind of new kind of Democrat. They came to power democratically, there were elections, but they showed no particular interest in democratic process, and they were almost fanatically interested in consolidating their own power, and not just individual power, but a kind of a cadre around them, their own kind of patronage system, and that's where the strength of their power lay, that it wasn't just one person like Kim Jong-un in North Korea, or a family, as in North Korea, but it was actually a very large patronage system that then benefited hugely from its participation in the state. As for everyday voters, well, you know, they were frankly unnecessary and unimportant for the functioning of this kind of patronage state. In other words, what many people had imagined in the 1960s, and I talk a little bit about this in the book, and that is a convergence between communism and capitalism, a convergence at the point of social democracy. In other words, communism would kind of reform itself along the lines of the Prague Spring, and America would reform itself along the lines of welfare capitalism, and at some point in the future, the two would converge at this social democratic point in the middle, not terribly different, say, from Sweden or Norway. That did not come to pass. Instead, we're seeing a different kind of convergence of kind of a market democracy and market authoritarianism, in other words, between the United States and China, at this point of authoritarian populism, in which you have democracy, but it's basically a screen for an autocrat and the autocrat's patronage system. So that's what I wanted to kind of build out in Ningxia and Xinjiang province, and to show how people like Gordon profitably interact with such a state, because, you know, it provides stability, the stability that you know, many people crave. I mean, if you listen to folks who voted for Donald Trump, they'll say, well, we wanted law and order. We're tired of all of the crime that's taking place, even though crime statistics have fallen over the last few decade or so. But that's what they want, law and order. They want some stability. They want an iron hand. That's what they call it in Russia. And this was something that, you know, that China values perhaps above all other countries, the harmony of stability. And here they find it in Ningxia, and Gordon, as I said, profits from his association with it.
Ningxia seems like a pretty enviable place to live, really, and if you're not too hung up on the notion of actual democracy.
That's correct. I mean, it's got good food, and the streets are clean. As his father points out, there's some indications that not all is well in Ningxia. There are beggars on the street. There's clearly a class of people who have made it and a class of people who haven't made it. But if you compare that to Brussels, which seems, you know, in a civil war, nonstop violence and chaos, Ningxia has much to recommend it.
We don't have time to discuss all of the main character's trips to see his children, but I do want to touch on the trip to Africa, to Botswana, to see his son, the son who dropped out of high school to go to Turkey to fight the caliphate. Basically,
that's correct.
He dropped out of high school to become a mercenary.
That's
and,
right.
And did quite well in his chosen field.
Absolutely. One could argue that all his children are successful in their field. It's just it doesn't make Julian particularly happy about the success, particularly his youngest son, Benjamin. Because, you know, here, and this is, you know, gets it at the degree to which someone is willing to fight for their beliefs. And, you know, Benjamin was very upset growing up to realize that his father in particular had strong beliefs, but was ultimately not willing to go the extra length to fight for them. And what I was thinking there was really the Spanish Civil War and the kind of generation of people, mostly young people, who went and fought in the Abraham Lincoln Brigade, who felt so strongly. They didn't speak Spanish. Most of them knew nothing about Spain or even about the Republican government that was being attacked by the fascists and Franco. But they felt very strongly that this was a battle that was of civilizational proportions, and that if fascism wasn't stopped in Spain, it would spread throughout Europe, which of course is what happened. Benjamin feels very similarly, that the caliphate represents a kind of civilizational challenge. If it isn't fought on the field in the Middle East, it will spread worldwide, and he's willing to make the sacrifices to do that. And he basically holds his father in contempt for trying to hold him back, and then for kind of dismissing his efforts. But of course, you know, Benjamin is both successful and unsuccessful. The caliphate is defeated, but the kind of premises behind the caliphate continue. And so whether it takes a similar form or a different form, we suspect that this battle is not over at all between, you know, those who follow this most extreme version of Islamic radicalism and everyone who doesn't. I should emphasize that, you know, I wrote a whole book on Islamophobia, and you know, I'm very sensitive to the critiques of radical Islam, which often are not critiques of radical Islam, but are frankly critiques of Islam, critiques of the Quran, critiques of Sharia law, critiques of things that are fundamental to Islam. And I wanted to make sure in this novel that I was identifying the caliphate as the kind of focus, and not Islam, and the kind of traditional aspects of Islam. And I would argue that, you know, the vast majority of the Muslim population of the world is as arrayed against the caliphate as non-Muslims. They find what is happening in Raqqa and Syria and in Iraq as disgusting and as not anti-Islamic as Christians, Jews, Hindus, and Buddhists. So I wanted to be clear about that in the book as well.
Well, because the book, the book tells you there's a lot happening that the author doesn't tell you. I imagined that the youngest son, Benjamin, had gone to visit a college campus in his senior year in high school and had been shouted down as an Islamophobe. That had, steeled his resolve to really make a big break from the ideology of Western liberalism and its, he's a very manly sort of character, and there's a trend to demonize testosterone, to demonize manly men, and then a pushback, by men who are displaying behaviors that they probably wouldn't if they hadn't been pushed. Mm-hmm. So Benjamin seemed emblematic of that cultural struggle to me.
Absolutely, and for Benjamin, the underlying issue is injustice. What he is battling in all of his campaigns is injustice, and he sees the caliphate as a kind of rebuke to the justice that is central to Islam, as well as central to, say, rule of law in the West. And it's such an affront that, you know, he feels he has to go kind of outside the traditional, you know, rule of law to combat it. And of course, he at the end of the book, we discover that he's involved in an entirely different campaign, which I won't talk about. But at the root of that too is his feeling that international corporations, multinational corporations, are acting in a fundamentally unjust way, and so he kind of changes his focus accordingly.
So you don't really spend much time talking about what happens to the United States in 2050 or by 2050. Can we go outside of the pages of the book and say, well, what's the U.S. like?
Sure. In fact, I wrote an essay to coincide with the book's publication last week that was from the point of view of Rachel, the ex-wife, who's living in Vermont.
Zone 9 Vermont.
Right. and she is living in Arcadia, which is this kind of intentional community up in the Northeast Kingdom. And she reflects on what happens in the United States between 2016 and 2015. So it kind of fills in that gap. And basically she says, there was this kind of increasing division in the United States, but people made the mistake of assuming that this division was because red state, blue state, or Democrat, Republican, or even between those who profited from globalization and those who didn't profit from economic globalization. Instead, she says, what the real divide is between people who believe in a federal government and those who don't believe in a federal government. In other words, people who believe in the kind of principle of integration and those who are uncomfortable with the idea of integration. And she identifies this as kind of a fracture point or a problem that has been inside the United States from its very beginning, that in fact this tension between states' rights and federal rights not only is embedded in the Constitution, but it precedes the Constitution. In fact, for several years, as she points out, the United States operated under the Articles of Confederation, and the states were perfectly happy to keep it that way. And the only way the United States came into being as a federal state was through effectively a bait and switch done by the founding fathers, who called a constitutional convention, which was supposed to just kind of modify the Articles of Confederation, but in fact completely threw it out the window in favor of a new constitution, which created a federal state. And effectively, there have been a class of people or a group of people that have been unhappy with that state of affairs ever since it came to the most dramatic conflict during the Civil War. But of course, it continues even today. And you saw that as well in the Trump campaign, where people were very upset over what the federal government forces them to do, whether it's pay taxes or read textbooks that include, evolution or have health care mandated by the federal government. But these, they felt, are not just bad in and of themselves, but they're bad because they are associated with federal power. And so, as she points out, between 2016 and 2050, you see the unraveling of this federal project as states decide that they, have had enough. And they've had enough for different reasons. I mean, you could have a conservative state that wants to establish, its own kind of Christian school system. You have another state like California, which, is upset, as we are seeing happening right now, upset with the prospect of the federal government under Donald Trump gutting environmental regulations and enforcing a new kind of immigration regime on the country. And California right now is looking into the way it can oppose that as a state. So these trends are already happening. It's not that hard to imagine the country fracturing in a way that at first will not be, like the dissolution of the Soviet Union, in which, the country actually falls apart, but it will still remain as a formal country, but all of the ties that are important, all the kind of federal ties, all the ties of integration become meaningless, and not only states, but communities, and ultimately neighborhoods go their own way, and you have a country which has no national purpose whatsoever, and the only purpose that can be found is purpose at the smallest possible level. And for instance, we see what happens in Arcadia, the intentional community where his ex-wife lives.
They have a well-stocked armory there.
They do, because of course, when the rule of law basically crumbles, then it is as Thomas Hobbes pointed out, a war of all against all. And there's not a lot of room in there for kind of Gandhian, you know, pacifist resistance, however well thought out it might be. And so this community, even though it is very much committed to, you know, say the principles of justice and peace and so forth, they knew from experience that unless they were well armed, they would be very quickly overrun, their stocks of food looted, and even worse, happening to the residents. So yes, they are extremely well armed, and everybody in the community is a very good shot. And this is helpful not only for kind of getting some wild meat every so often, but also fending off any potential attacks on this community.
There's a genre of science fiction called cli-fi, which is climate fiction. And I think probably the biggest name in that genre is Paolo Bacigalupi. Mm-hmm. He wrote The Wind-Up Girl and Shipbreaker, and he's got a book called The Water Knife, which takes place in the Southwest in the middle of this century. And in it, the United States federal government has authorized the states to control their own borders, which is to say, you know, if you live in Nevada, you don't have to take any refugees from Arizona or Texas. And then Texans are the refugees that everybody doesn't want. They are, I'm not sure what the current, you know, parallel would be. Who are the most unwanted refugees today?
Well, Afghans, probably.
So Texans are the new Afghans in that book. I bring it up because my question to you is, how much of this book is a warning and how much of it is genuine, heartfelt prediction?
Well, it was supposed to be mostly warning, and you know, obviously events have caught up to the book. I wrote a piece not long ago about the failure of the integration project with respect to school integration, school desegregation, and there's only been one kind of method that has ever worked in terms of bringing up the school scores of African Americans to the level of white students, and that is school desegregation. Forget about charter schools. Forget about after school programs. Desegregation has been the only thing that works. So why, if we know that it works, if we actually have all the statistical background, all the proof we need to go forward with desegregation, why aren't we doing it? Why did, in fact, desegregation end in the early 1980s? Well, because there was no political support for it any longer. And I'm afraid that is, the direction we're heading in the United States, that there may be all sorts of solutions that are very effective, and we have all the statistics to prove that they will function as we plan if implemented, whether we're talking about energy issues or environmental issues, education, infrastructure, all the policy wonks have put together their white papers and it all looks great and we have the proof that it works. But unless there is a political belief in the population that, in other words, not just belief, but faith, I would put it, unless there is faith that it's worth kind of compromising in order to implement these integration projects, they're not going to go forward. Even if, no matter how many experts say that, that it'll work if implemented. And that's what I'm seeing. That's kind of that's the warning, if you will, that if we stop believing in this larger integration project, it will fall apart. Because we've seen that happen already. I mean, the loss of belief in Yugoslavia was rapid. It took place in a period of less than 2 years in a country that hitherto, it had its problems, no question about it, and it had its tensions, but at a kind of level of the population, there was a commitment to the country as a whole. It can unravel very quickly, and that's the warning part of it. I hesitate to predict that will happen because I do think that that this is not inevitable. It's not it's not preordained that large multi-ethnic countries or organizations are fated to fail. I think they're fated to encounter major challenges, but they can as easily overcome those challenges as fall prey to them. And that ultimately is the challenge that we face right now. Where we will find the courage or the commitment to kind of hold together the country, I have some ideas about, but that would be somewhat polemical and not in the realm of fiction.
Well, I would love to have that conversation with you sometime. Unfortunately, the time allotted for this conversation is gone and then some. But I very much appreciate your taking the time to talk to me. I really enjoyed the book. I hope a lot of people will read it. And thank you much.
Thank you so much. This was a great conversation.